second question, how many of you have ever seen a cornfield? Well, according to Vox.com, there's a really good chance that cornfield that you've seen is genetically modified. Because of all the corn grown in the United States, 93% has been genetically modified. And 65% of processed food in grocery stores contains genetically modified ingredients. And now, this might seem really shocking and kind of terrible because people don't really like their food to be messed with, and genetic modification tends to get a bad rap. However, today I'm going to be persuading you that there are many, many benefits to genetic modification. As a consumer and an agriculturalist, GMOs are discussed very often, and I hear a lot about them. And I've done extensive research to unearth the benefits of GMOs. Today I'll be discussing how they improve crops, protect the environment, and increase agricultural yields without increasing land use. To start off, I'm going to give a little bit of background info on genetic modification. The definition of genetic modification is the selection of individual genes and the transfer of them from one organism to another between non-related species. This goes back to Gregor Mendel with his selective breeding of pea plants and crossbreeding to produce desirable offspring. So it's pretty much how wild grasses became wheat today and how boars, wild hogs became pigs, for example. Today it's referred to as biotechnology, genetic modification, and crops that have been genetically modified are often called transgenic crops. The first argument I'll present to you is that GMOs improve crops, and they do this in a multiple amount of ways. To start with, they create stronger crops by increasing resistance to viruses and tolerance of herbicides and pesticides. An example being Roundup Ready soybeans, which I'll talk about a little bit later. They also extend growing seasons. According to the risks and benefits of biotechnology, an academic journal article published about strawberry and Arctic flounder, they took a gene from the Arctic flounder that tolerates cold temperatures and put it in strawberries so that they can be grown longer in northern climates where it's colder. Another example of improvement is they expand growing environments. So an example of this is cactus and corn. They take the gene from a cactus that is able to tolerate dry climates and place it in corn so that they can be grown in drier climates than is typical of that crop. The second argument I'm presenting to you is that they protect the environment. Farming is very hard on Earth. Especially tilling, which is a weed management technique. Tilling breaks up the soil, it causes erosion and runoff, as well as removes necessary nutrients from the soil. Herbicide-resistant crops are more capable of handling herbicide, which is a spray that's spread over fields to remove weeds, so that tilling is not needed. No-till farming is really great for the environment, and it doesn't remove as much nutrients and it keeps the soil healthier. And the soybeans that I talked about earlier, Roundup Ready soybeans, are, according to modern ag practices, conserve resources. They are making the way for plowless crops, which this is an example of a plowless crop here. So you can see that the soil has not been touched in between the plants. It still has last year's crops laying on it. Less tilling means less use of diesel fuel because there's less use of equipment, which means that GMOs are allowing the agricultural industry to reduce their carbon footprint. And the coolest way, in my opinion, that they help the environment is they revive dead farmland. Irrigation is really an important part of agriculture, and it leaves behind a lot of salt in soil, and salt renders farmland infertile. Nothing can grow in it. And what they've been doing, what genetic modification scientists have been doing, is creating crops that are tolerant to salty environments so that they can be grown on this dead farmland and make it useful again. Lastly, I'm going to talk about the increasing agricultural yields without increasing land. 38% of the Earth's land area is farmland and pasture, and the Earth's population is growing at a steady rate, whereas this percentage of land is not, and it's actually decreasing in some areas. genetically modified crops are able to grow larger at faster rates on the same amount of land or less as non-GMO crops. And when compared to organic farming decreases yields by 34% because they've used limited pesticides and herbicides and have losses from weeds or pest infestations. According to Cornell University's Alliance for Science, a review of studies concluded that genetically modified corn has increased yields significantly in the last 20 years. And the genetic literacy policy states that GMOs have increased yields by 5.6 to 24.5% based on their relative crops and have lower levels of mycotoxins and fumonisms, which are harmful to animal and human health. So improvements in agriculture, advancements in agriculture are being made daily, and GMOs are one of the most controversial of them all. People are skeptical about their risks, their benefits, whether they're safe or not, but they really do provide an extensive amount of benefits, and there's more than I have presented to you today. I hope after hearing this, you are open-minded about what GMOs do to protect the environment, how they improve crops, and how they increase yields. And I hope that you will consider, before you buy GMO products, instead of being taken aback by them or scared of them, consider the good that they do for the environment.